looking back, sometimes I do find it a little bit difficult because, like, it was kind of like an easier time. And now it's like, oh, things are hard.
Hello, she is the fashion icon of Drag Race Season 3. Do you prefer tea or coffee? Or do you prefer Tia coffee? Hey, Tia!
Hi, I was on Season 2.
Bootleg Opinions.
Girl, you like this wig I'm wearing? Guess what? I bought it with cash reward points that I earned from YouGov.
YouGov? What's that? Tell me more.
YouGov is a way to make extra money and also earn gift cards through surveys, product reviews, and also brand reviews. Join in on the fun, baby. They got gift cards for Amazon, Target, Nike, etc., etc., etc. I'm telling you, if you're a busy person like me, you can do this anywhere, anytime, anywhere.
Girl, that's so easy. I could do this anywhere, at any time. I'm signing up.
YouGov is the tea, so start taking surveys to earn extra cash and also gift cards. Now, sashay your way to the link in the description and use the link to sign up for YouGov. And thank you, YouGov, for sponsoring this video. I support this message.
Oh, I can buy whatever I want now. Maybe a nice runway look. Do you know what I mean?
She is the fashion icon of Drag Race Season 2. Please welcome. Do you prefer tea or coffee? Or do you prefer the whole thing?
Well, I could never say. It's an industry secret. But it does say I don't want to see any H&M.
But are you wearing H&M?
Do you know what I am wearing, though? I don't want to show favorites, but I am wearing my Victoria Scone merch.
Oh, I love Victoria, and she is a fabulous queen on Drag Race Season 3, and I cannot wait to see her blossom on Drag Race because we need more representation on Drag Race. Am I correct?
You are correct. And you know, fun secret, technically she's my drag daughter as well.
Well, sometimes the daughter is better than the mother, you know. I'm just kidding. I'm just kidding. Now, you are an iconic queen from Season 2. You served so many funny moments. You were so hilarious in a lot of the challenges, and you definitely slayed in the competition.
Oh, thank you. I mean, I did my best, didn't I? Because, as we all know, I wasn't exactly the fashion icon. So we had to try and make it work in whatever way that we could. And do you know what? We did it. And now I'm just living my life.
And we're about to get the inside scoop of your thought process behind your looks. And I cannot wait to pick your brain apart, baby.
Oh, I'm scared about this because I know how you do with some of these looks. And I'm like, what are you gonna say?
I'm not gonna say anything. This is all about you, baby. This is all about you. Who needs all-stars when you can get the redemption here, right?
Yeah.
What was that yeah for? You sound like you didn't believe me. We briefly met and talked before the cast was announced for your season, and I had no idea you were on the season because I remember doing like a Facebook show with you. It was your show. And I remember, oh my God, this queen is so funny. She's well-spoken, she's hilarious, and she has great looks from the waist up. And I thought, why isn't she on Drag Race?
I remember that as well. It was called Lockdown Legends, and it was like a drag competition. Because obviously that was in the 7-month break that we had from filming Season 2. What better way to take my mind off the intensity of Drag Race than just doing my own drag competition in lockdown? And it was amazing. Thank you so much for judging as well.
Of course. So you produced your own bootleg version of Drag Race UK.
You know, bootleg queens right here, bootlegging together.
The lifestyle of bootleg is that you get to have fun.
Like, that's the energy that we need in the world, is just sort of like having the best time, living your best life, and not taking things too seriously. Ru says it all the time.
And you definitely put out excellent music. How do I sing this so that I don't crack my voice? From the outside in.
Yeah.
You have a beautiful voice, your music videos are fantastic, and you definitely served model-esque looks.
I mean, maybe we should do a duet after your iconic Ankh song. Like, I feel like maybe we should do a little musical moment together.
Do you think I'm a singer, Tia?
I think anyone is anything that they put their mind to.
And then what?
Maybe, have you considered rapping as an option?
How has it been since your journey on Drag Race Season 2?
Oh my God, it's been absolutely incredible. Honestly, the love has been amazing. I'm just like so grateful to get back out there and be like working and doing shows and actually meeting people in person, because obviously we had to watch our whole season in lockdown. So it was really, really difficult.
One of my look editors thought that your name was a play on Tia. You know what Tia is in Spanish, right? It means auntie.
Oh, auntie. I'm everyone's auntie.
And he was like, why is her name Auntie Kofi? Who is Auntie Kofi? Like, he doesn't get it. And I had to explain to him, Lorena, Tia Kofi is the play on tea or coffee. And he was like, oh.
I mean, I'll take it. I'll be your auntie if you want me to be. I'll be your daddy if you need me to be. All of the above. Don't worry about it.
All right. First look up is your promo look, which I thought you absolutely slayed. You looked beautiful. This is what Tia Kofi is all about.
This look, I mean, we're a queen on a budget, you know what I mean? So this look was done by one of my friends, David Henson. We literally went around like the market, got like the fabrics and everything together. And like, it's actually inspired by my own heritage. There's like a traditional Nigerian goddess. And we took like elements of like some of her costuming from like artwork and stuff. And things like the shoes, which everyone hated, are like snakeskin.
I love the shoes.
Oh, do you love them? Oh, yay!
Yeah.
They're snakeskin shoes to like represent the python that this goddess like traditionally had with her. So I just wanted to, in this look and some of my other looks, I just really wanted to reflect my like Nigerian heritage and my culture.
And you definitely did it with the hair, with the draping in the back, the silhouettes and the fringe at the bottom, and even the bracelets, the gold ones. And of course, you have your name, Tia, as your earrings. Beautiful in this.
I don't want people to forget, do you know what I mean? You gotta remember who Tia is. She's here.
She's your auntie. Your naughty auntie.
Auntie is what the earrings say. Auntie.
All right, here is your second look. And your second look is your entrance look. The iconic entrance look.
This is the one that got me called basic. I got voted as most basic and then everyone called me basic forever. Oh, it was so stressful.
It's not bad to be basic. As long as you're rememberable.
Exactly. Basic and bootleg. That's what we're doing. That's what it's all about. The real tea is that I didn't actually choose this look to enter the workroom.
Was
the
actual... No, it wasn't. Oh, wear this, girl. Okay, yeah, I'll wear this.
My actual entrance look didn't arrive in time. So literally it was like a last minute choice. Me and my ex-boyfriend stuck about 30 rhinestones on it and were like, yeah, that's gonna look great. And then I walked in and was like... Wow, everyone really came with the fashion this season. Oh no.
Are you saying that the standards for season one was a little bit low, so you just kind of met there?
All I'm saying is if I was stood next to Bagger, I'd be looking gorgeous. That's all I said. All I'm saying.
If I'm standing next to Bagger, I can be RuPaul, honey. Because you talked about a look that you didn't get to wear. What was it?
Sort of like African patterned jumpsuit with a cape, because I wanted to like enter with a West African fabric and finish in a West African fabric as well. To like represent my culture, because it's so important to me to do that, because we don't have enough representation of all sorts of different cultures on screen. So I just wanted to really try and do that. But instead, I ended up wearing the outfit that I probably would have worn for my Mel B snatch game.
I thought you were gonna say finale. I don't know why my head was going to there, because do you remember that look Candy Muse wore for season 13? It was like the train look or something, and she was gonna wear it for the finale, but when she walked down the runway, it was like, oh my god, it was so bad.
Yeah, I know the one. It was a choice.
But you know what? It's memorable. That's what I'll say.
And you know what? I stand by my frizzy cultural moment that was my hair, because I did that. That's basically what my sister's hair looked like when I was growing up. So I was like, I'm doing this for my family and no one else, thank you.
Here's the thing about Drag Race though. Not many people understand, but as long as you stay true to who you are, that's all that matters. You know, sometimes there are review shows out there, they don't get a look or they don't understand it or they might not enjoy it. Mm. It's about serving you. You know, you're not gonna be everybody's taste, and that's something that I've learned throughout the years from Drag Race, you know.
Yeah, I think so. And I think you've always stayed true to who you are. That is, yes, that wasn't meant to be a pun, but it accidentally was. But you have done, and I think it's gorgeous. I think you're wonderful.
Oh, thank you.
It's a day of compliments.
We don't want to get cancelled, right? Because the fans are a little bit harsher now.
Literally.
Next up is your Alan Turing with all those coats on the jacket and the pants.
So what I want to say...
Say it, girl.
Because everyone came for me and was like, you don't look like Alan Turing. And I was like, the brief was an outfit inspired by... So technically everyone else did it wrong because they just cosplayed. Like people came for me and was like, this is just like a Smithy's cosplay suit. So the fabric is actually like a custom fabric. I've done a show and tell. I came with a show and tell. It's like a custom fabric in rainbows because this binary code spells out the word love. So it's all about like LGBT love and the fact that Alan was persecuted for his sexuality and he invented modern computing.
And he helped end it World War II. Mia LaGanja talked about how he was like a beautiful representation for LGBTQ community. When he first came out, he wasn't accepted and he was depressed and he ended his life. And I think we also have to remember he was one of our heroes, not just for the LGBTQ community, but also for the entire world. And I want to say we did enjoy your look, except the pink bra, because we did see it again in the second look.
That pink bra, I basically wore it every single time I was wearing anything in the workroom, because I was like, it fits, it's comfortable, it'll do. But like Taste, every single time would come for me and be like, not the pink leopard print bra again.
Well, say this back to her face. Oh no, not the long human hair again.
I mean, it did come up a lot, didn't it? It did come up a lot.
What is it?
Well, it came up a lot.
Oh, I thought you said it got knotted by the end, you know, because like sometimes if you don't wash it, it becomes knotted. Next one is your hometown look, and you are serving a look from Nottingham, I believe, right?
Yeah, I'm Robin Hood. I like this one because I'm like a massive geek. So I was just like having a little cosplay fantasy, trying to give you a bit of Legend of Zelda mixed with Robin Hood, mixed with like this. I'm not actually from Nottingham. I'm from Essex, like Cheryl Hole.
Davina DeCampo, we did the first bootleg for the promo looks, and she said, you're a liar. She's not actually from Nottingham. She's actually from Essex.
I am a liar. I did it because Essex was where I like found myself and like really sort of like came out of my shell and all of that kind of thing. So I was like, it feels like home to me. And also Cheryl already did like the only Essex look. So I was like, I've got no options. So everything that I wore on the show, I had made, even though everyone thinks that it all came from a costume shop. So, I mean, we blew the budget on some questionable looks, but...
You blew the budget on $100. I'm just kidding.
No, true though. I'm poor. Drag was my full-time
job. I'm poor too, girl.
Yeah. Like, I was doing drag full-time, so it's really difficult because I'm like, what money do you want me to spend on this? I'm not going to turn it down. I want to be on Drag Race, so I'm just going to have to make it work. And like all my friends were like helping me out with like wigs and stuff. This wig is like so old and so crusty, and I had to get my friend Poppy Cock to try and like plait it into a braid for me and stuff just so it looked neat. This look really sums up the mission that it was to do everything on a budget. But we got there. We were on the show. We did it.
I liked it when you walked down with this look. The only thing that I think me and Lagan just said was the fabric choice. We enjoy the huge bow. We enjoy the red lining. We enjoy the high boots. It was really fun. It was just the fabric choice. But overall, we did enjoy this look.
This is fun. This is like memories.
It is.
It's like this is your life.
Have you looked at your looks since your season or rewatched some of the old episodes?
Do you know what? I haven't rewatched the show.
You can probably relate to me as well. As a contestant who's been on there, sometimes watching back, it's kind of cringy. You feel a bit awkward and uncomfortable. Am I correct?
Yeah. Yeah, definitely. And also, like, it was such a difficult time. Like, if I watched myself walk into that workroom, that was before the whole world changed. So, like, it's actually really difficult sometimes looking back on those moments and thinking, like, we were so excited to be on Drag Race and all of this was kind of happening, and like how suddenly like we've all got to get vaccinated against this global pandemic and all of that kind of thing. Like the world's literally changed. Looking back, sometimes I do find it a little bit difficult because like it was kind of like an easier time and now it's like, oh, things are hard.
So I was laying in my bed. I was scrolling through your stories. I think it was like 6, 7 a.m. in the morning. It's probably like, you know, morning time at where you are. You probably remember this. So I saw your story, I replied to it. It was like you showing a clip of this news anchor, and she seemed like she's had no clue who she's talking to. She's never seen one episode of Drag Race, and she was talking to you. Do you remember this?
Yeah, I do.
Because she was like, so what happened to y'all during the lockdown? You were like, we had to stop production. So what happened to y'all after the filming? We couldn't work. So who won? You were just like, let me just say this, I won. And she just went with it. I don't think she even knows who she's talking to. I thought it was hilarious.
Not a clue. She literally was like, yeah, good luck. Like, who won? I was like, me, I won. I won the whole show. You didn't watch it, so you have no idea whether I did or not. Like, it was so funny. It's like, you've got one job. You've got to talk to me for a minute and a half.
And it seemed like somebody just handed her like a piece of paper with like the bullet points. You're speaking to someone from Drag Race Season 2. Her name is Tia Kofi. She's a contestant. Talk to her. She has no clue what's going on. And you're just sitting there like, what the f-? And the thing is, I find it especially even more funny because you're at your home, and during these news press stuff, they make us wake up super early, and just in my mind, I'm just thinking, oh my gosh, she's probably thinking, she got up for the interview in the morning, not getting paid, and she's sitting hot in her room doing this bullshit interview that's going nowhere.
Yeah, literally, I was like, thank you so much for your time. She always argues with people and stuff. She's a really sassy, like, well-known news anchor. So I was like, do you know what? Kay Burley, I'ma come for you today since you come for everyone else all the time. So.
She's a well-known reporter, but probably not well-known in her facts, right?
No, clearly not. I just put my pigeon back. He fell over.
Mm-hmm.
He was so mad about that news report.
All right, next up is just surprise, surprise, surprise. And here is your surprise.
Right, I think it's
funny.
I think it's hilarious.
I think it's funny.
Like, the whole idea of the look, to just sort of, like, rip off the mask and, like, live the femme dream. Does she look cheap? Yes. Is she sending you a message? Yes. Absolutely. In my lovely leather daddy look.
I'll let you talk about it. This one is fine. All right, next up is your surprise, surprise look number one.
Okay, so did the tearaway come off quickly? Yes. Did other people's reveals take about half an hour to get off? Yes. Is this dress ugly? Yes.
Quick question, because you said you had a designer make this and you spent a lot of money for this, how much did you spend for this? I believe you said $500 or $300.
This was actually made, even though it looks like you could get it at a party store. I know, lesson learned. We've grown, we've evolved. I'm gonna learn to sew at some point, one day.
When I first saw this look with his hair, all I could think of was that salsa emoji with the girl dancing, you know what I'm talking about? And you literally bury that.
That's what I wanted to be. I was like, salsa emoji, camp. Let's be an emoji on the runway. But originally, I wanted to have it up for when I was like wearing the leather daddy outfit and then like rip it down and like shake it out. But like just before I walked on the runway, all I could think about was, do you remember on season 7 when they did the Glamazonian Airways?
Yeah.
And like Sasha Bell was like, never, never, never. And she couldn't shake out her ponytail. That's all I could think about. So I was like, just leave the hair down. Just don't risk it.
You don't want to be Sasha Bell number 2, right?
I've cracked the code.
And what is the code?
Don't wear flat hair on the runway and dress like a salsa dancing emoji. That's the code.
All right. Next up is your monster look, which I absolutely lived for. I mean, I think you got top favorite look from Bootleg Onions because you definitely served us monster. You gave us silhouette, you gave us shape, you gave us color, you gave us goth, you gave us monster, you gave us scary, you gave us horror. There was a concept and you served it and you gave us drag, baby. And I loved it. And you stuck to who you are, which is that West African, Nigerian, I don't wanna, you know, say the wrong thing, correct me if I'm wrong, you know, that voodoo aspect of it.
Religion basically in Nigeria and across West Africa. So I was like, I'm gonna give you some voodoo priestess. I'm gonna give you that like West African flavor and bring it to the runway. And also she had curves and swerves for once. I actually did have like body and like padding and stuff on. So I was like, good for me. I finally started doing drag on episode 4. That's great.
Speaking of doing drag, how long have you been doing drag?
I've been doing drag for 7 years. So I started in the same competition as Something Wong. We started in the same year and it was like Yeah, she's amazing. And it's a national drag competition. There's like 200 people who enter it. And me and Something both got to the final. And Something came third. And me and my girl group, the Vixens, came second. So I am officially better at drag than Something. I thought I was being really clever. So Medusa usually turns people to stone, but I was like, I'm doing voodoo, so she's gonna turn you to bone. So I've got like these skeleton snakes and stuff instead of like the full snakes and a giant skull, which was free because my ex-boyfriend used to work on a TV show.
That was his head.
Yeah, that was his head. That's why he's an ex now.
Of course it was free.
So I found out some things and we actually broke up in the lockdown. So that made it a lot harder going back to the show. I don't think anyone actually knows that.
Got it.
Yeah.
Got it. He did some things. I can already predict what that is.
Yeah. Okay. But that made it really hard going back to the show. Because I like came out of a 4-year relationship and was like...
4 years? That deserves a championship and a trophy. You've been for 4 years. Wow. Applause.
Well, yes, I had been, yes.
You deserve a repeater badge just for that.
Oh my god, I'll get one for $10 off World of Wonder website.
Yeah. I know, they sell that on the website too. And at TrackCon, anybody can win a challenge now.
You win a challenge, you win a challenge, you win a challenge. I never won a challenge.
Mm-hmm. Me neither. Next up is your design look, which I enjoyed. I thought that this was pretty fabulous. I mean, not the best of the entire group, but like, it was decent, I thought.
I don't sew. I know you should always like try and learn to sew, but when you find out that you're going on Drag Race, you do not have a lot of time. So I was like, when am I going to learn to sew? I've got to carry on working and doing all my gigs to earn enough money so that I can pay for these looks. I didn't have time to learn how to like put a thing in a thing and then do the thing. Like, I did my best with hot glue and bringing hair up again. Something taught me to sew one dress before I got there. And when I arrived, there was not enough fabric because I'm so tall to make that one gown that she taught me to make. And I was like, I can't figure out how to do this with two different fabrics. So I'm just going to make it up. That's all I can do right now. We only had what was in that box. And I was like, oh, I've got the same thing as Veronica Green, who's a foot shorter than me. This is a lot of challenge. Like, this is a big challenge. 6'5". I've got to make an outfit.
Mm-hmm. Next up is your prehistoric look.
I think I look like a pigeon. It's fair enough, yeah. Here she is on the actual costume as well as the headpiece. I did actually rhinestone things. You just couldn't see it.
Yeah, sequins show up better.
It was literally like 3,000 tiny rhinestones. Who knew? Rhinestones don't show up on TV very well. I didn't know that. But now I do.
I think like a really short hair, and if you walk down like really model-esque, I think it would have sold the look. I think it was just the hair that was the problem. But overall, it was decent, you know.
And this over here, she's giving us like a children's birthday outfit where she's ready to sing happy birthday to the 5-year-old kid. Is this giving me Drag Race? No. Is this giving me even bar or local bar? No. This is giving me like, I have a Saturday gig and I'm gonna go sing happy birthday at a children's birthday party. At a park.
It was all right.
I think the headpiece does look like a pigeon. I think the actual outfit itself, I think it's quite cool how it's like structured to the body and it's got the sleeves on it. The material's very like sort of skin sort of texture as well. And then all the sort of like details that are like sort of sprayed and painted on. I think it's quite cool. I think the headpiece is cheap. My bad. And I think the hair is a choice. But we learn and we grow and we move. And now maybe one day I'll dress as an actual pigeon.
I remember you lip syncing, you took off the headpiece and your dress came out a little bit higher. I was like, oh my gosh, she looks like a model. No shade, the more it came off, the better you look, honestly.
Oh, thank you.
No shade, no shade, that's no shade at all.
This hair, it looks very homemade, very home done. Because it was, they wanted to see bigger hair and more of a silhouette for me. So I'm panicking big, like, what hair do I have that is big? I have none. So you just gotta make it work. And I was sort of like there, like, trying to backcomb and like pour a kettle on top of like plaits to try and get some sort of texture and stuff.
Anyway, moving along to your ice cream look.
There she is, the ice cream cone. I love her forever. I think it's hilarious. I look so stupid. Like, it's great.
I remember you posting your look on Instagram and and you put like a hot guy in there to like, I guess, I don't know, like, made people not notice the look too much.
Yeah, I was like, okay, the only way this is gonna get likes is a hot shirtless man.
If you put a hot guy in there so that it kind of get distracted by the look itself, people would still click like, but for the guy, but maybe not for the look.
Yeah, but do you know what I mean? That's called planning. That's strategy.
Now, something I've noticed with the queens on not just your season, but like every queen that's gone out of Drag Race is that sometimes their look are a little bit like, eh, like on the runway. On Instagram, it's completely fire in the back, sparkles on top, water, airy, like a goddess. I was like, oh my god, that's not how you really look on TV, girl.
I mean, I don't hate the look. I get what everyone said about it. I've got my little bracelets that are like drips of ice cream, which is cute, and my little cherry on top, and my like 50s wig, like the little nail gloves. I think she looks cute.
And you got your little cherry, baby.
Exactly.
Now last is your finale look. Gorgeous. Tell us more, baby. Now with all these looks, did you draw it out and then you took it to your designer, or your designer gave you like several options, or you worked along with the designer to make them?
Yeah, so I just sort of like talk to people and like give them like my ideas of like how I sort of like see it in my head. I don't really like sketch it out or like anything like that. I'm like, okay, I want this, this and this, and that's kind of how I want it to look. And then they obviously bring their own elements and their ideas and stuff to the table. So like, I love this look. It was made by the same guy who did my promo look, the orange one.
Two looks which I absolutely adored. Props to your designer.
Yes, well done, thank you, Henson. It's a West African fabric and it's red, white and blue for the United Kingdom. So that's like me bringing my British side and my Nigerian side together right at the end. My big sort of like Afro textured hair. And I love it. I think it's gorgeous. And this little sort of like harnessy design as well. I was like, cute.
You dressed up as RuPaul in the finale challenge.
Yeah.
Remember what she said? Like, oh, you, of course you remember, you were there. I just wanted to point out to the audience, just in case they didn't catch the reference, she said that if you have a bunch of people doing the makeup for you and the hair and the costumes, you will be me. And then you said, can you lend me your team? And then you came back as a bootleg RuPaul in the main challenge, dancing for the finale in the back. I was like, work, you better slay, girl.
I actually had a different like finale dance outfit for that. And they were like, you have to wear that one because it fits the theme better. And I was like, mm-hmm, yeah, I will. And then I just turned up in the other outfit. Because I was like, I want to walk out dressed as budget bootleg RuPaul.
Yes, honey.
Because it's camp. It's camp. It's half the fun. Do you know what I mean? It's like me and Thorgy Thor. We're now sworn enemies.
I announced you coming on and someone in the comments said, is she going to review Thorgy Thor's looks?
Oh my God. I mean, should we just do some now?
Which one is your least favorite look?
I actually think it might be the leather daddy harness because I think it's really funny, but it's not exactly put together. It's sort of got like saggy boobs on it as well. Like there are little details. Like I don't know why he thought that was my skin tone because it's not. Everyone in the comments is going to be like, no, it's the salsa dress. The salsa dress is camp.
I was just about to say it's the salsa dress for me too. That was my least favorite. The macho look wasn't the worst for me because I knew the direction you were going for, which was camp, funny, comedic. It wasn't meant to be taken beautiful. Whereas the salsa look, where I thought you were kind of taking it into like fashion-y and pretty, but it didn't really go there. That was the look that I least enjoyed. But you were fantastic on the show. You blossomed, you put out great music.
Thank you.
You know, and that's all that really matters. So enjoy that wave, baby.
Oh, we're doing it. We're doing it. We're having the best time. It's gorgeous.
And stay gorgeous, my love. Now, Tia Kofi, thank you so much for giving us your bootleg opinions on your Drag Race looks from season 2. And where can we find you?
Oh, you can find me everywhere at Tia Kofi, TIAKOFI. You can find me on Twitter, TikTok, Facebook, not really Facebook, I don't use it, Instagram, at Spotify, iTunes, the television sometimes, here on Bootleg Opinions, everywhere.
Now I pronounce you a bootleg queen.
Yes, I made it, I did it.
Everybody goes on Drag Race just so they can graduate onto bootleg. And my name is Yuhua Hamasaki. You can find me on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, and YouTube, and new on TikTok under Yuhua Hamasaki. And if y'all had a great time today, our Venmos and our PayPals are in the link in the description below. Bye, Tia!
Bye, thank you for having me!